not expected to be a major factor in this year's race. 7-Eleven hopes for overall victory lie with their newest star, acquired during the off-season. He is Steve Bauer from Ontario, Canada. He is aggressive and a team leader. But he and his 7-Eleven teammates will be tested by two of the strongest teams in the world, Panasonic Sportlife and PDM, both from Holland. Panasonic will be without last year's top sprinter, Erik van der Baarden. He was let go during the winter and has been replaced by a first-year pro from East Germany, Olaf Ludwig. The 1988 Olympic gold medalist, Ludwig is one of the fastest road sprinters in the world. Henk Lubberding is the veteran and last year's runner-up in the Tour de France. But director sportif Peter Post chose not to bring his two strongest climbers, Steven Rooks and Gert Hant Tunisa, despite the more difficult climbing in this year's race. For Panasonic, their only true climber is Soviet-born Viatcheslav Ekimov. Ekimov rode this race with the Soviet Nationals last year and was impressive. This year, he will ride it as a pro with one of the world's strongest teams behind him. PDM, though, has the most variety in their attack. Erik Breukink is making his first visit to American racing. An excellent climber and a strong time trialist, he is anxious to see what the terrain will be like. Rudy Dhaenens is the quintessential classic rider. Capable of dramatic solo attacks, he is the team workhorse. And Raul Alcala. Alcala comes into the race in his best form in years. He is beginning to see himself as a leader. The race will begin in less than 24 hours. The Tour de Trump takes place in the northeast corner of the U.S., traversing six states and covering over 1,100 miles. It has been suggested that this will be the most difficult stage race in U.S. history, beginning in Wilmington, Delaware, and ending in Boston, Massachusetts, 11 days later. The riders are preparing for the 3.1-mile prologue. For the U.S. amateur team, the Tour de Trump is a major test in their season. Many young riders are moving up quickly through the amateur program. One rider showing great promise is Bob Julick of Glenwood Springs, Colorado. Just 18 years old, he is already demonstrating the skills needed to be a world-class rider. Ekimov showed his talents as an amateur last year. Now, as a pro, his world record speed could win him the opening prologue. Ekimov rolls both tires on the second corner. A mechanic's error will cost him 32 seconds and put him in 85th place. Panasonic's problems continue. Henk Lubberding missed his start time, an error reminiscent of Pedro Delgado's prologue faux pas in the 1989 Tour de France. For 7-Eleven Steve Bauer, the pressure to begin the race strongly is intense. The press considers him the favorite to win overall. Greg LeMond on the cobbled back section of the course. For the world champion, the Tour de Trump is his first race in 5 weeks. For all practicality, this is a training race. LeMond's primary focus this year is to again win the Tour de France. Things become worse for Lubberding. He's passed by the rider who started behind him. The rider is a Soviet amateur, number 114, Vladislav Bobrik. Bauer powers up the hill in the saddle. As he comes to the finish, he eclipses the time of his teammate Sean Yates. He has taken over first place. But before the crowd can relax, it is Steve Speaks of Team Crest who rolls across the line 0.2 seconds ahead of Bauer. 2 years ago, Raul Alcala rode for 7-Eleven, but feeling that he would never be able to ride out of the shadow of Andy Hampsten, he left to join PDM. Now, riding in the U.S. for the first time since his victory in the 1987 Coors Classic, he takes the prologue by almost 7 seconds and will be the first to wear the leader's jersey.
Hey, who's that? Mark, listen right back. Hey.
May 4th, the first of two double stage days. In the morning, a 95.6-mile road race from Wilmington, Delaware to Baltimore, Maryland. In the evening, a one-hour timed criterium. For Alcala, some good-natured kidding comes along with the leader's jersey.
Sure, sure, yeah, sure. Hey, hey, come. Hey, come.
You're the leader.
Hey, you're the leader, and you... Hey.
All right. I say to you,
this will be a warm-up ride. The weather is a chilly 52 degrees, and with the threat of rain, few will want to see a fast pace, especially so early in the event. William Polito of Manzana Postobon attempts a solo break. Postobon is considered a team of talented climbers, but lacks a rider with the strength to win the overall. Their goal, and the goal of many of the pro squads and amateur teams, will be to win a stage. Polito was told his lead is 1 minute 10 seconds. He will attempt to gain as much time as possible over the next miles. The pack is hardly concerned. The race for Polito is simple. Time trial away as strongly as possible. Stay within yourself and hope the pack miscalculates when to begin its chase. As they cross the Susquehanna River, the halfway point, Polito is 10 minutes off the front. The feed zone is generally chaotic, even at this high level of racing. Here, Andy Hampsten shares his lunch with Peter Rose from Lotto. Rose prefers Belgian food. Immediately after the feed, PDM begins the chase. Up front, Rudy Dhaenens, followed by teammates Nico Verhoeven and Erik Breukink. A few miles later, a crash occurs. At first, it appears harmless, but then Victor Hugo Olarte from Postobon is seen down. He is not moving. He is unconscious. A rider who witnessed the crash explained that Olarte lost control of his bike and hit a telephone pole straight on, his helmet striking the pole first. Considering the speed of impact, his helmet saved his life. Hours later, he is fine. The pack is still chasing. Polito's effort has left him exhausted. Within 25 miles, his lead is gone. His effort was too much. He will later finish the day more than 10 minutes behind the pack. A strong counterattack is launched by Steve Bauer of 7-Eleven. But Bauer's move is not a surprise, and it is covered quickly. He decides to back off. The pace is slow as the peloton approaches the Baltimore city limits. On the wide highway approaching the city, a four-man break attempts to get free. But Panasonic reels in the threat, knowing that one of the riders is PDM's Erik Breukink. Suddenly, on the far side of the road comes another attack. Again, it is Steve Bauer. His spring classic form seems to be showing today as he again attempts to break free. The first to chase is Canadian amateur Ed Kazmierczak. He passes Bauer. As he checks under his arm, there is another rider on his wheel. It is Ekimov of Panasonic. But Ekimov is merely covering. The goal for Panasonic is to set up their sprinter, Ludwig. As they approach the downtown harbor finish, it is clear. The race will be decided by a field sprint. Big Michael Zanoli of Coors Light leads out the last 400 meters. 7-Eleven's Davis Phinney is coming off his wheel. It looks like a two-man sprint, but then Ludwig makes his move and takes the victory. Today's second stage will be more work than the leaders would like. The threatening rains arrive. Criteriums are never enjoyable under these conditions. The tight corners and wet roads string out the pack from the beginning. John Yates of 7-Eleven leads the pack as it approaches the bell lap. Suddenly, a Canadian rider attacks. Then, American amateur Jay Vonderhey powers off the front. But by the corner, he is caught and passed by Coors Light's Chris Huber. Huber is making a strong move on the back side of the course. The Coors Light rider holds a 30-meter lead on the pack with 400 meters to go. But he is caught. And Olaf Ludwig wins his second stage of the day. With the sprint time bonuses, he takes over the pink leader's jersey. After a two-hour transfer, the race arrives in the historic town of Fredericksburg, Virginia. Today's stage will take the riders through gentle rolling farmland. The 88-mile course offers no topographical feature that would break up the pack.
Mr. Lamont,
yeah.
Can I have your autograph? Thanks. Thanks a lot. Thanks. You good, Jess? Thanks.
Feel better. Good luck today, Mr. Lamont.
For Mr. Greg LeMond, the early spring season has been a disappointment. Races which are so crucial to conditioning had to be abandoned due to a virus. For the crowds that gather at the start and finish, LeMond is the most coveted autograph one can get. Raul Alcala remains confident after losing the leader's jersey yesterday. For him, the race will not begin until the race reaches the mountains tomorrow. Wearing the leader's jersey early in a race forces your team to try to control the race. The extra work will fall on Panasonic's shoulders now.
Riders ready!
At 10 a.m., the race begins. After 2 days of chilly, overcast skies, the riders are glad the weather is favorable. With no sprint time bonuses along the course, and with the peloton aware that later this day there will be a 39-mile team time trial, there is no expectation of a fast pace. For Olaf Ludwig, this is an easy morning ride which should conclude in Richmond with another pack sprint victory. With that in mind, the riders take the opportunity to have some fun.
Deluxe. This is the latest flavor.
Okay, we'll pretend that this is the breakaway attempt.
Even the world champion can't help but get in the act. It is 25 miles into the race. Mike McCarthy of Subaru Montgomery slides in behind the NBC camera bike. The motorcycle accelerates, and so does McCarthy. Controversy arises. The officials rule that the motorcycle is motor pacing McCarthy away from the pack, giving him an unfair advantage. Upon review, the advantage seems more psychological than physical. It appears to be another morning joke. The pack is moving at approximately 20 miles per hour. McCarthy accelerates to perhaps 25 behind the motorcycle. He gains 75 meters. If the pack had wanted to, they could have made this distance up quickly. When McCarthy sees no one is behind him, he attacks. 7 seconds later, a pair of riders begin chasing. It is Vladislav Bobrik of the Soviet Union and Bach of Lotto Super Club. An Olympian in 1988, McCarthy is an excellent time trialist. Soloing to victory is something he is more than capable of doing. It takes 10 minutes for Bach and Bobrik to catch the U.S. rider. If they join forces, there are only 55 miles to Richmond. Bobrick is 18 years old and a top pursuer and individual time trialist. His talents, coupled with those of McCarthy and the 23-year-old pro from Belgium, make this a strong trio. They are 3 minutes ahead of the pack. The leader's jersey is in jeopardy. Panasonic begins chasing. Stringing the peloton out, they quickly begin to close the gap on the break. But Peter Post, realizing that he does not want to set a precedent that his team will do all the work in this race, gambles and shuts the chase down. As the pack rolls along, Bauer and Lauritsen discuss the situation. The feeling in the peloton seems to be that the escapees will be caught. Another chase develops. This is led by Raul Alcala of PDM. He is trying to motivate the pack. Often it takes the presence of someone with a chance to win at the front to ignite the pack into chasing. Race favorite is forcing the pace. Alexei Graywall of Coors Light is in his best form in years. His focus all spring has been on this race. A Soviet rider in red and two Lotto riders break the rhythm of the chase. The break is now 10 minutes clear. The strongest teams sense they have let the break get too far ahead. Now the best pro riders are working together. Helping lead the chase is Sean Yates of 7-Eleven. The stage concludes with 3 laps of a 2.25-mile circuit in downtown Richmond. As the break comes through for the first time, those in the finish area are surprised. No one expected these three to stay away. Ludwig leads the pack into town. He is working hard, but the leader's jersey is gone. The pros have been upstaged. On the last lap, Bobrick is pulled clear and wins the stage ahead of McCarthy and then Buck. Three minutes later, Ron Kiefel leads out the sprint for fourth on the patchwork cobbles downtown, but it is Michael Zanoli on the outside who hits the line first. McCarthy's father is on hand. His 21-year-old son does not have a chance at the overall victory, but for his hard efforts in the break, he is awarded the most aggressive rider jersey. Vladislav Bobrick has won more than the stage. He now leads Olaf Ludwig by 2 minutes 58 seconds. The amateur rider has taken the pink leader's jersey on a stage when nothing should have happened. Stage 4, the team time trial. This was to be the stage where the world's best pros would all but eliminate hopes for an amateur victory. After a 39.8-mile course, the difference between the pros and amateurs could be as much as 5 minutes. For this reason, the amateurs argued that the team times should not count toward individual GC. A compromise was reached, which would give one-second bonuses to the top 10 teams. A stage, which initially seemed the most important, was now merely a showcase. Panasonic displays the form that has consistently made them one of the best time trial teams. But even this effort will only get them third place. Disorganized and exhausted, the Soviet amateurs are forced to wait for three teammates who have been dropped. Their youth and lack of experience is showing. In contrast, PDM is a machine. Every man's efforts calculated and maximized. Alcala's pulls are inspiring. If 7-Eleven is to come on form, they need a great performance here. The team's morale is low after the morning's indecisive error. With a strong final lap, PDM finishes with a time of 1 hour 16 minutes and 2 seconds. They lead Panasonic by 4 seconds. The split times for 7-Eleven have been impressive. By the finish, they have beaten PDM by 52 seconds. But the question remains, in a race where overall victory is so important to the success of 7-Eleven's season, was it wise to put in such a tremendous effort on a stage where all they gained is pride? It is finally time for the climbers to take a stage. Today is the first test for the legs and the hearts of those who would be champion. The first 20 miles of the race are neutralized. This is done to conform the distance raced to Pro-Am regulations. After two difficult days of high-speed action, the pack is not eager to begin racing. It has become a bike tour. For more than 5 hours. There is a reason for this leisurely pace. The riders know a 3,000-foot climb awaits them at the 100-mile mark. Few pro riders would think of attacking early, and for the amateurs, the 145-mile race may be the longest they have ever done. Just after the feed zone, three riders managed to get away. They are French pro Philippe Casado, Richard Vivian, a French amateur world road champion, and Nate Reese of Subaru Montgomery. The Soviets position themselves at the front. For these riders, the goal is to build a lead before the climb in hopes that if the pack splits, they'll be able to stay with the lead group. The riders now worry only about one thing, positioning. Strong climbers do not need to be directly at the front. They will slowly increase the pace until the weaker riders have been dropped. But for race leader Bobrick, he must ride at the front. He has never ridden against the pros and cannot expect to stay with them over the top. This short climb is a good warm-up for the legs. It is also where a rider will watch another rider's form, his face, look for pain. Casado did not look good on the small climb. Vivian and Reese know he is not in top form. The pack has given the lead group a 3-minute, 30-second lead before Yates picks up the pace. Director sportif Roger Leger of Team Z Kickers talks to Casado.
Catch.
Wintergreen Mountain is part of the Blue Ridge Range. It rises 2,800 feet in just 6 miles. Casado cannot hold on. Out of the saddle, Reese leads much of the climb. The grade of the road is more than 15%. For Mexican Raul Alcala, these climbs are his home. His pace quickly shatters the field, including race leader Bobrick. Bobrick displays his first amateur weakness. It is not his legs, but his face. He shows when he is in pain. Alcala is followed by Norwegian athlete Karlsvall. They are 75 meters clear of Bobrick. Reese continues to lead the climb. The amateur Vivian is not smooth. He labors through the climb. As they near the top, Reese wants Vivian ahead of him. He slows and tries to force Vivian to take the lead. Meters from the summit, Reese still leads the climb and is looking strong. He keeps checking for Vivian's position. Then Vivian shifts. He has played possum for the entire climb. It is a great move by the amateur. He wins the $1,000 King of the Mountain Sprint and continues over the top. Now, how far behind will Alcala and Karlsvall be? One minute, 10 seconds. They have picked up more than 2 minutes from the base of the climb. Reese has got back up to Vivian. The Frenchman is not recovered from his attack. It is still 4 miles of rolling uphill. It did not take long for Karlsvall and Alcala to recover. Within minutes, they catch the break. Andy Hampsten is with the next group of climbers that cross the summit just seconds behind the leader. Also, there is Bobrick. Surveying the 20 riders, he finds only one teammate with him. Casado once more is forced off the back. Karlsvall will be Zed's main hope now. Vivian's early effort has left him on the verge of blowing up. He drops back to the second group. As they approach the start of the downhill, Alcala comes close to missing the turn. Recovering smoothly, he sets out to increase the lead. The chase group now numbers 30 riders. 7-Eleven's Bauer and Kiefel discuss the final miles of racing. Back at the front, Karlsvall takes a strong pull. He then signals Alcala to come through by a wiggle of his elbow. The communication between the riders is minimal. This signal allows the group to keep the rotation fluid, efficient. Then Alcala signals for Riche to take his turn at the front. Riche does not pull through. Alcala lets him know he's not pleased with his lack of effort in the break. Bauer's hard work has closed the gap, but they will not catch the three escapees. As Riche, Alcala, and Karlsvall enter downtown Charlottesville, Virginia, all that is left is the sprint. The amateur Riche has the most kick left and wins the stage. The pack, once again, is being led by Ron Kiefel. Ekimov appears to have fourth place, but then Verdonk of Lotto, on the inside, takes the sprint. For Nate Riche, his failure to help the break should not overshadow his 55-mile effort with two separate three-man breaks. Bobrick, in turn, was aided greatly by a chase group that could not let Alcala get away. And Alcala showed impressive form and strength, but only gained 13 seconds on the young Soviet.
Please, Greg, please, man, it means a lot to me.
I know, but there's so many people.
Greg! Thank you, sir.
Come on, Greg, did you sign this?
A tired, but still gracious Le Mans was to lose more than 30 minutes to the leader.
I thought I was riding better last year here. You know, but you can make a lot of improvement in 2 months. A month you can make a lot of improvement. In fact, I haven't raced in 5 weeks and I haven't ridden hard in 5 weeks. That's half my problem. It's 90% of my problem. I'm bad everywhere right now. I'm basically dead bike rider on a bike.
You know, it always surprises me when I'm out on the East Coast how steep the climbs are. You know, I live in the Rocky Mountains. It's supposed to be the hardest riding in the country, and you don't think of this as being a real severe test. But I came out here last year, and the hills in the Tour de Trump are very unforgiving.
Yeah, like 5 or 6 because I didn't eat last night.
Okay.
He just body slammed himself at like 20 miles an hour on the pavement, so he almost dislocated his hip. He's not feeling okay, but he's pretty tough. going to try to tough it out. We'll see. If there's too much pain, he probably won't finish today. There's no need for him to. It's not worth it.
For Peter Post, disaster struck yesterday before the climb to Wintergreen. Mark Sargent and Guy Newlands withdrew from the race with a virus. With DeRoy still nursing his injury, and Ekimov low on GC after his opening prologue. The message was clear for the powerful Panasonic team. Their race was over. Paul McCormick of Team Crest unleashes a powerful attack 77 miles into the day's action. Quickly, he is joined by Coors Light's Todd Gogulski and Zed Kicker's Pascal Poisson. Poisson is at a disadvantage. His two companions are both on teams managed by Len Pettyjohn. Indirectly, they are teammates. Though none of the riders was a threat to the overall lead, the Soviets began to chase when the break had gained 10 minutes. The Soviets knew better than anyone how quickly a three-man break could change the race. Suddenly, Gogulski attacks, fearing his sprint cannot win him the stage. But he has failed to notice another tactic employed by the Frenchman. His coach, Len Pettyjohn, explains.
And he didn't realize the subtlety of Poisson's move. In the last 15 to 20K, he was taking 1% off his pulls each time. So it's a, you know, it's an experienced pro. I mean, the guy's been around for 13 years. And it was kind of stupid to attack Poisson on a climb. I mean, you got one of the best climbers in the world, and you attack him on a climb.
McCormick manages to stay on Poisson's wheel and refuses several times to go to the front. As they come off the last turn, it is Poisson who surprises McCormick by jumping with 250 meters to go. The wind is coming from left to right. Poisson, knowing that the crest rider will come up on the protected side, drifts right. McCormick cannot come around. Gogulski has learned a lesson that only comes from years of racing. There are no sour grapes. For the veteran Poisson, there is the feeling that he has just taught class. Pro cycling, broken down, is a series of decisions. Whose wheel to jump on in a sprint? Which brake will succeed? When to relax? And when to put the hammer down? Andy Bishop has decided to attempt a 70-mile solo break. For Bishop, this is a chance to showcase his talents. In 1988 and 1989, Bishop rode for PDM, but he had a slow start in 1989 and then rarely raced for PDM. At the start of this year, he was without a team, his future in cycling uncertain. Mike Neal, former director for 7-Eleven, now with Spago Finlandia, called Bishop before the race to see if he would like to ride the Tour de Trump. For Bishop, this is his chance to prove that he can still ride with the best in the world. Two riders attempt to bridge up to Bishop. They are Verdonk of Lotto and Abadi of Zed. At mile 129, Bishop is shown his time check. Not only has he increased his lead over the pack, but over the last miles he has increased his lead over his pursuers as well, gaining more than a minute and a half. Bishop still has 35 miles to go. Less than 48 hours after his injury, Alexei Graywall is forced to leave the race. If this was just a single attack by a rider who was no threat to the leaders, not much would be said of it. But two breaks occurred during this day, both on climbs, and both times Bishop was in the break. His counterattack, just before the second break was caught, showed his determination to win this stage. Miles from the finish, Abadi and Verdonk are caught. The peloton is now just 5 minutes back. After 138 miles of racing, even small hills can make the muscles burn. As the pack enters the city, it is clear. Andy Bishop, Spago Finlandia, will win. Two days before the race concludes in Boston, Bishop is asked to ride the Giro d'Italia for 7-Eleven. When the Giro ends 1 month later, Bishop finishes as the highest placed American. Wednesday, May 9th, 8 a.m. After two long road races, it will be difficult for all but the strongest to complete the morning time trial and still have something left for the hilly 71-mile circuit race at 3 o'clock.
Yeah, Raul is better and better every year. He's growing to a complete rider, and his time trial is going better. The mountain's going better. He's better in his brains are growing in to ride in the classement. And the meaning for all this is the Tour de France for the next 2 years.
Потому что в гонке все смотрят на лидера, и поэтому очень.
Because in a race everybody looks at the leader, and therefore it becomes difficult because all the other riders try to control you and not let you go up ahead.
Bauer lies in third, 2:59 behind Bobra, but more significantly, he trails Alcala by only 19 seconds. Kalsvall is just 1 second behind Bauer. He is known as an excellent time trialist.
And he's really living up to that.
Kalsvall's teammate is having one of his better days. Le Mans' time for the 16.5-mile time trial is 35 minutes 11 seconds. It will be the fastest time for nearly an hour. Back on course, Bauer's split time is excellent. It is the same as Ekimov's. Alcala is next out at the gate. And finally, Bobrik. The Soviets have always been disciplined in time trials. Their results are rarely disappointing.
Possession of the pink leader's jersey. He was the best young racer in stage three.
Lachey of Zed Kickers Taco Bell encourages his rider. Kalsvall's effort is tremendous, and he takes the lead by 22 seconds. Steve Bauer has just passed the halfway point. Suddenly, disaster. He is given a traditional road bike with a disc wheel. Bauer would later admit to making an uncharacteristically amateur mistake. At 35 miles per hour, he chooses to cross the tracks on his time trial bars rather than the bullhorns. The difference? He is unable to jump the tracks or even unweight his front wheel. Once he has flatted, he is unable to control the bike. Three years ago, his replacement bike would have been considered state-of-the-art. Now it costs him seconds a mile. He will finish 2 minutes 35 seconds behind Alcala and will fall back into 10th place. Bobrick's split times were slower than Alcala's. He too was losing seconds a mile to the Mexican, but not because of aerodynamics. The PDM rider shattered Kalsvall's time by 25 seconds, but the important difference would be his margin over Bobrick. The young DuPont-sponsored rider crosses the line 1 minute, 5 seconds slower than Alcala. Seeing the crowd-lined streets ahead, he was not sure he had gone through the finish. Having finally slowed, he found himself still in the leader's jersey.
I play second?
Yeah.
Right now, it's at the
Are you Erik? Erik?
Erik is 34.
You first?
34
and
47.
Shutdown.
Okay. Thank you.
34-26.
Who do you think is the biggest challenge now?
Yeah, you had a good
time. I think Adley. Now he's more than
you. 4 hours have elapsed since Bobrick crossed the line. The pack does not need any warming. The circuit race course is 22 miles long, with two major hills and one shorter climb. The Lehigh University Hill will be ascended three times. Thousands of fans line the road anticipating tremendous action. Sean Yates is struggling. It will be a long race for the Englishman, still feeling the effects of a lingering virus. The attacking is continuous for the first two laps. Neljubin is chased down. Then Bruno Bonet of Carrera. A break of McCarthy, Wayne Bennington of Zed, and PDM's Jos van Aert stayed away for a while, but as they enter the last circuit, the pack is together. Going up through the fraternity-lined Lehigh climb for the last time, Alcala is increasing the tempo. On his wheel, in the green mountain leader's jersey, is Kalsvall, followed by race leader Bobrick. Alcala cannot shake the Soviet on the short, steep climb. At the start of the second climb, Alcala bursts from the pack. Covering for Zed is Henri Abadie.
Thank you.
Finally, Kolsvall responds, and in doing so, tows Bobrick along with him. Other riders joining this break are Coors Light's Steven Swart and Team USA's Bob Julich. Also bridging up is Bruno Huguer of France and Panasonic's Ekimov. But as the grade increases, Ekimov is shed. Next, Bobrick. Then Julich. And the reason is not the steepness, but the pace being set by Kolsvall. It is for this reason he is wearing the green climber's jersey. His long legs give him great leverage, and his style is smooth. No wasted energy. Only Alcala can hang on. Bobrick must chase down Alcala. He has tremendous assistance from the experienced Ekimov. Ekimov knows they missed pickup time on the descent. He calls for Dmitry Zanov to pull through. On the back is PDM's Rudy Dhaenens. Dhaenens' role is to dispute the chase. He is sitting in the second position behind Ekimov. As Ekimov finishes his effort, Dhaenens sits up. He is forcing Bobrick to work harder. Bauer leads the chase from the pack. Having lost so much time in the time trial, to let Alcala and Bobrick get away would be admitting defeat. With four of the five chasers making strong efforts, they have caught the two leaders. Ekimov is working hard for his countrymen. As they regroup, Dhaenens counterattacks on the final break. This is not a solo chance for victory. Instead, PDM is attempting great strategy. Dhaenens is climbing the last hill before the finish. If Alcala or Kolsvall can once again drop Bobrick on this climb, then the two can join Dhaenens on the descent, and the three-man break could possibly stay away to the finish. The chase is catching them on the descent. Bauer, continuing his attack, has made up ground on the break. With the help of Steve Speaks from Crest, it appears now the race will come down to a pack sprint. The first to jump is Craig Schomer. He has a two-bike lead on Poisson and appears to have a victory. But once again, Ludwig burst through from nowhere to grab the stage. The 30-year-old East German is completely dominating the sprints. For race leader Bobrick, he is another day closer to Boston. With the weather turning bad, today's stage promises to be one of the most demanding so far. The weather is supposed to get worse. The Soviets feel the pressure in defending the jersey today. PDM is applying tremendous pressure. They establish a break up the road and hope that on one of the two final climbs, Alcala will be able to bridge. If the Soviets have to chase under these conditions, it will be exhausting. A terrible crash occurs on a steel deck bridge. The injured are Henri Abadi of Zed Kickers, taken to the hospital with a fractured shoulder blade, Hank Luberding with broken fingers and lacerations, and Maximilian Sciandri with a broken wrist. PDM's strategy is beginning to pay off. Acting PDM Director Sportif Jonathan Boyer keeps his riders informed on the second to the last climb. Erik Breukink leads the field. Karlsfall and Alcala follow.
Voilà, t'es? Ouais. Fais bien attention, tu restes avec Alcala. Hein. Il y a plus d'une minute derrière, mais allez, les 5 PDM vont rouler. Hein. Hein? Il les a fait attendre pour les faire rouler.
Leger informs Karlsfall of the break up the road. With so heavy a stacked PDM squad, the race appeared over for Bobrick. But in the confusion of a rainy day, a mad chase by 7-Eleven and the Soviets reunited the pack before the last climb. Then four riders jump. They are de Klerk, Zanoli, Van Orso, and Kiefel. Across the top, Kiefel makes a strong move. On the descent, Kiefel has managed to lose everyone except Zanoli. Later, Alcala and Karlsfall cross the line. Ten seconds behind them, Bobrick. This is an important stage for Ron Kiefel. His effort puts him back in fourth place with three stages to go. For the 22-year-old from Haarlem, Holland, this race could fulfill a promise. Michael flew his grandmother in from Holland just today, and he promised her if she came over, he would win a stage for her. He keeps his promise.
Do you think you can win? Do you think you can win the
race?
I don't think so.
Потому что сегодняшний этап показал, что Рауль очень сильный. Он...
Today's stage showed that Raul is very strong.
И он победу не отдаст.
Что?
И он победу не отдаст.
And he's not going to give up easily.
Central Park is supposed to be a rest day. But before 2 miles are gone, there have been two major attacks. As the race traverses the north side of the park, five are away. In that group are Steve Bauer and Mike McCarthy. For Mike McCarthy, this is his single-day world championship. Mike lives next to Central Park and has ridden these roads since he was 13. In his training, he may have dreamed of racing against the world's best. Now, he is doing just that. Chasing down the break are the Soviets and Panasonic. Bauer's presence in the break has cause for concern. PDM has little reason to fear Bauer's presence, but with a 2-minute lead over the peloton, other teams are worried. Zed is one of them. McCarthy is flatted on the backside of lap number 8. Mavic neutral support is ready with a tire change. Now McCarthy must chase. The pack is doing the same. Five minutes, and McCarthy is back on, exhausted. It is Canada's Ed Kazmierczyk and Michael Loftus of Sweden. Bauer, Eaton, and McCarthy wait each other up. The Canadian takes the victory. For McCarthy, frustration. Tomorrow, the race will move to upstate New York and the Catskill Mountains. This will be the day that a young Soviet amateur will win or lose the 1990 Tour de France.
The only race is difficult today. Tomorrow is not so difficult. I have to win today or stay in the second place, or I don't know.
Please welcome Ed
Kasper. For Norwegian Atle Kalsvold, he trails Alcala by 40 seconds.
Get on my face!
For Le Mans, the pressure has finally shifted off of him. He will complete the race and his training for the Tour de France. For more than 3 months, everyone has talked of one deciding factor in this 11-day race. It comes just 20 miles into today's action. It is called Devil's Kitchen. The profile map also shows the final two climbs, which could break the field up should the pack regroup on the long downhill. In the miles leading up to the climb, positioning is crucial. Even LeMond moves to the front. Bobrick has faced pressure all week, and he has responded. Today, PDM's shadow is intense. Now, visible in the distance, the Catskills. For Kaltzwall, this is the chance to see if Alcala is preoccupied with Bobrick. A mistake, and the Zed rider could steal the pink jersey. LeMond is instrumental in leading Kaltzwall to the front. It is important your top climber be fresh. He should not expend energy before it is needed. Steve Speaks of Team Crest has been a surprise. Here he leads Kaltzwall on the left and Rudy Dhaenens on the right. The pace is fast. Next to pick up the lead is Dhaenens. The PDM rider will attempt to set a tempo that forces Bobrick to show whether he is struggling. Alcala is riding next to the amateur. If he begins to show pain, Alcala will increase his tempo and move to the front. Dhaenens' pace is splitting the pack. At the front, a lead group is developing. AC Pinarello has proven to be a strong team. They have three riders in the front break. Also included are Hampsten, Kaltzwall, and Alcala. The question remains, how far back is Bobrick? 30 seconds back in the second group. Hampsten is climbing without any hard effort on the 15% grade. Staying in the saddle, he is back in top form. As the riders clear the top, they are looking for the gap between themselves and the next large group. Erik Breukink is all they see. He is joining three other PDM riders in the break. Bobrick crests the climb, 1 minute, 5 seconds down. He must recover before organizing a chase. PDM's Verhoeven will mark Bobrick's efforts. Attempting to bridge is Bauer, Bishop, Plyshev and Thurlow Roger. Bauer has come down with bronchitis and is finding it difficult to breathe. His effort does not show it. Twenty miles after the climb, the break is 3 minutes, 35 seconds clear. The Soviets, engaging in an all-out assault, try to reel the break in. Four-man chase, led by Bauer, has miraculously rejoined. While the 19-man break continues to increase its lead over a chasing Soviet team, this break of just four managed to erase its 40-second deficit. At the front, the PDM team is secure. The race against the Soviet is over. The lead is now more than 5 minutes and growing by the mile. But Alcala is not content in simply winning. Lotto's Verdonk accelerates on a small hill, and it is Alcala who responds. He does not have to, but it is his show of strength, of dominance. His confidence is carrying his riding. His reactions are those of a man who knows his body will respond to all that he demands of it today. For Bobrick, there is one last duty he must attempt while wearing the pink jersey. Convince others to chase.
When Bauer not ahead, then we go. But...
Phinney cannot chase so long as Bauer is up the road. But he sees valor in the 18-year-old's reluctance to accept the inevitable. The bronchitis has caught up with Bauer on the second to the last climb. He must slope and wait for the main peloton. He will wait for 25 minutes. In contrast, Steve Speaks attacks to win the mountain sprint, after which he relaxes and falls back with the leader. The stage win is all that is left, and James Urbanus of Spago, Finlandia, is attempting to solo. As he enters the final long straightaway to the finish in Albany, the pack is gaining quickly. As he senses his lead slipping away, he summons the last of his energy. It is pure adrenaline. It is a great win for Urbanek. And Speaks and Nate Reese close out an American threesome. Last year, after this stage, a young Soviet amateur named Ekimov shocked the pros by taking the race leader's jersey. This year, Devil's Kitchen was tamed by the pro. Bobrick would finish 32 minutes, 42 seconds down. Even the weather on this final race into Boston could not dampen the victory. For Vladislav Bobrik, the experience of being the race leader had taught him much. To borrow a phrase from author Peter Nye, he has showed the heart of a lion. In one final defiant move, Bobrik attacks. There is no chance at victory, just redemption. PDM would control the day. The top five riders would not change. In fifth, Viatcheslav Ekimov, Panasonic Sportlight. In fourth, Dmitry Zanov, best amateur, Soviet, DuPont. Third place would go to Erik Breukink, PDM.
It would be nice when you can win in the United States.
Athlete Kalsvall, Zed Kickers, Taco Bell would finish in second place. As Coors Light's Michael Zanoli outsprints Olaf Ludwig and Davis Phinney for his second stage win, the 1990 Tour de Trump comes to an exciting conclusion. For the thousands of fans on hand in Boston, it is a chance to cheer for a great victory. And a great victor. Raul Alcala finishes the 1990 Tour de Trump in 45 hours.